Let's welcome Josh to the stage. Thanks for being here.
Is there a mic?
I don't think I'm gonna do good standing in one spot like this. Hi, my name is Josh, and before we get started, I actually made a post just now on social media because this is the first time that I've done my talk without the aid of my before and after pictures. So if you're interested in seeing what I looked like before, go to Instagram or social media, or Twitter, whatever your favorite is, and look me up by name. Lajaunie is my last name. You can find me, follow me. And I put a series of about 9 images and one real quick video that I wanted to share with you guys. And it's me finishing my 100-mile race. Not to, spoiler alert, I did a 100-mile race last year. So anyway. My name is Josh Lajani. Like Caitlin said, I'm from South Louisiana, born and raised. I'm what we call a coonass, and that is just a term of endearment that we use among ourselves. It just means basically that you are a swamp-dwelling bayou boy or girl, and that is, you sound like me. You grew up hunting and fishing, and more than likely, you better be a Saints fan. Those types of things, right? So I grew up in South Louisiana, hunting, fishing, playing football, wanting to be just like my Bam Bam, my grandfather, my dad, my uncles, the patriarch of my family, the people that I looked up to, the older guys, the older cousins in my family. I wanted to be like those guys. And so I spent an entire childhood being untaught how to be empathetic and compassionate to animals. And the very first act of killing my first animal as a young boy, learning how to kill a rabbit, learning how to kill deer, and having the blood smeared on my face the first time, learning how to, you know, dispatch a tuna as you drag it into the boat. And these were all things that were done without a sense of remorse or without a sense of feeling like a murderer. This was keeping up tradition in my culture and in my family in particular. This is what we did as a pastime. And like I said, I wanted to do these things. They weren't forced upon me. I wanted to do them because I wanted to be just like the people I looked up to. It's important. And I still have those very visceral reactions when I think about the nostalgia connected to these things that aren't very palatable to a vegan crowd, and I totally get it. And so I apologize to you guys for the very first image, if you are looking at social media, that I posted to help aid my talk today on your own personal device. So living that lifestyle and upholding that identity was very important to me. I mentioned my grandfather, I call him Bam Bam. He always stood 6'3", 385, 390 pounds my entire life. He was like, he hung the moon to me, you know? And so he's in a place today because of those lifestyle choices, because of those food choices, because of those traditions that is a very sad thing for me. He's very, he's got progressive dementia, Alzheimer's, due to years and years of cardiovascular disease and the pharmaceuticals that accompany that disease. And so now he's not nearly the physical specimen he was before this big hulking presence in my life, stomping around and being the ruler of everyone I knew. He was an entrepreneur. He was the boss. He was literally always in charge of every group of people we were ever around. And I looked up to him, and I wanted to be just like him. And I did everything in my power to outdo him, whether it was whiskey drinking, whether it was learning how to clean and speckle trout faster than him, skinning a deer faster than he could. I did all of these things, and I did them with pride as a way to uphold an image that had been held up to me by my elders, and to make them proud of me, right? And so living that lifestyle, not only doing those things as far as the hunting and the fishing and the consuming, because it wasn't just about the hunting and the fishing. He was also a magnificent cook. He was always in charge of the crawfish boil or the barbecue or the fish fry. And so we did all of those things. We still have all of the tools, the pots and the pits and all of the stuff, right? And so not only did we go out into the wild and procure these things as food and fill the freezer on a regular basis, but we also filled the pit on a regular basis and fed groups of people, not unlike what we have here today. I would more than, you know, a dozen times in my life have fed hundreds of people at a time with my grandfather. And so living that lifestyle of going out and the consumption of alcohol and junk food that goes along with a camp trip, that goes along with being at the deer camp or the fishing camp or being on the boat, along with the actual cooking of those animals after we, you know, wrap up the trip and then we bring it home and we do the stuff. Living that lifestyle got me to be a very big young man. I was, you know, approaching 6 feet tall at a very early age, probably 13, 14 years old. I was already over 200 pounds and had size 13 feet. And I was just a big guy. And I was proud of that. And that big guy status led me to be an asset on the football field. I mentioned being a Saints fan as being part of Louisiana culture, and I think it's a very important part of Louisiana culture, if I might say so myself, and as a very biased season ticket holder, right? All right. But along with getting big and fat, I didn't consider it fat, I just considered it big, and following in the footsteps of my grandfather and my dad and everyone else, along with that was the idea of being a football player. So I was playing football at a very early age, and in the, you know, third and fourth grade, fifth grade, I was already starting in the third grade where I got my very first Saints uniform with a helmet and the pads and the whole deal. And me and my brother would just go out in the yard and run into each other like Rams, you know. And so by the fifth grade, I was actually in organized football, and I was relegated to the line, which is what most, you know, big, heavy white guys, especially on the football team, get relegated to, is we're not very athletic, and we just kind of get put on the offensive line. And we're not fast, we're not a lot of things. So we get relegated to the offensive line, and we need to be big, right? So having that familial history and those examples of what a man is supposed to be in my life, along with this sport in my life, by the time that I was good at this sport. I really was. I was good. I made it through high school. I was probably 300 pounds by my senior year in high school, approaching 6'2", 6'3", as a senior in high school. I got a full scholarship to the University of Arkansas in Monticello. And my coach contacted me in the offseason before I got there. He said, "Hey, man, you're great on the defensive line. I like how you look on film, but we want you as an offensive lineman up here, so we would like for you to put on 30 pounds or so." So I put on 30 pounds, and I was 320 pounds by the time I got to training camp that year. And that was a different – that was, you know, make a long story short, I was bigger and heavier than I'd ever been in my life, trying to survive through my first NCAA training camp. And it was really a toll on my body. I wound up getting hurt, losing my scholarship, flunking out of college, doing all of that stuff, right? The normal thing. And then after college, I go back to the things that I know. I go back to, you know, drinking and hunting and fishing and doing all of that. So as my life progresses, I get up to late 20s, early 30s, and I am 400 pounds by now, right? I had always been a big guy, and although I talk really positively about how I envisioned myself and wanted to be like my elders and wanted to be a big football player and all of those things, I had a big cousin, I had all of these people that I looked up to, but secretively, I didn't want to be fat. It didn't really help with the girls very much as a teenager. That wasn't fun. So multiple times throughout my life, I had tried to lose weight. I would pick a number. I would say, we need to lose 50 pounds. We need to lose 60 pounds. We need to lose 80 pounds. And I would curb my food intake just long enough to lose that finite amount of weight and then celebrate by going back to those very same foods that I had to give up to lose the weight. And I was in that loop my whole life. So there was always this kernel of me wanting to lose weight and feel better about myself. I mean, there were really dark moments when you're a 300 to 400 pound guy and in the transition of getting fatter and fatter and fatter and seeing your first stretch marks in high school and being embarrassed about being on senior trip and not wanting to go to beach because you see the first stretch marks on your side. It's not, and you got boobs, and you know, there was once a girl in my senior class, we were at a pool party, and she didn't mean it, anything by it, but she said, "Damn, Josh, you have bigger boobs than me." And it was a weird moment. She wasn't trying to be vicious, but it stung, it hurt, right? And so I'd always had this kernel inside of me that wanted to take weight off of this body, and it never really came to fruition. I always made head fakes at it. I didn't really know what to do about it, per se, right? During one of these weight loss stints, I had lost about, say, 50 or 60 pounds, and at the time, that brought me down to about 275 pounds, and I was feeling light and svelte, and I was feeling like a lady killer. And I went to a bar, and I met my wife, who we had already known each other, but I met her that night officially in a dating capacity. We'd known of each other, but this was the first time that we had actually had conversation and kind of dug each other and all of that stuff that goes along with that. And so I wind up dating this woman, this girl, this very brilliant, beautiful female. And I was worried at the time that she just liked me just because I had lost the amount of weight that I was that night, right? And she made it clear to me as we started dating that because she knew how big I was before, and she made it clear to me she doesn't care about how I looked. The aesthetics doesn't matter. She will love me forever. And she made that very clear to me. And so that was all the permission I needed. In the next year and a half or so, I put on a good 125 pounds or so. I really tested that. And I was right. She stuck with me all the way through the whole thing, right? But what she did want me to do was see what she saw in me. She wanted me to see the same potential in myself that she saw in me. I had always sort of been relegated to the offensive line of life and always thought of myself as less than when it came to how I looked and when it came to how I was able to perform physically, getting in and out of the boat while it's trailered. I would look like an old man because I was so fat and overweight. When it came to like riding on an airplane and needing an extra seat belt or going to a restaurant and surprise, only booth can't fit. Right? So I always felt less than, and it bothered me when I would walk in front of the mirror on the way to the shower and just look at myself and go, what the hell did you do to yourself? And how will we ever do anything about this? When will it ever go away? Will we ever be able to fix it? Right? And so my wife saw potential in me that I never saw for myself. And I think what she wanted to do was to harbor that and fan that potential into a flame. And she talked me into going back to school 7 years after I had failed out and lost my football scholarship. 7 years later, I didn't think I needed to. I own my own business. I work on sewer pumps for a living. It's not a very glorious or glamorous job, but it is a job, and it is my own business. It's my own company, and I do it for myself. So I didn't understand why I would need to go to school and get a degree, because I'm not going to go and use the degree to get a job. So I couldn't understand that. But what she was wanting to do was for me to, like, sort of just grab the reins of my own potential a little bit. And she talked me into going back to school. I went back to school, and she was right. It was amazing. I started reading things. I became more pragmatic. I became a guy that would pick up a book. I was never that guy. I hadn't read since, like, Jonathan Livingston Seagull in, like, the third grade or fourth grade or whatever that was. I think maybe I read halfway through Karate Kid 2 when it came out in a book form and mostly just looked at the pictures, right? And so, because I had seen the movie, I knew what it was all about. So I was like, why read the book? So anyway, so my wife is like actually talking me into reading things that shake my idea of what like is, like shake my idea of what fact is, you know? And I often talk about this that the first thing she talked to me into reading is just, it was a fiction book, but it was the Da Vinci Code. And coming up on as a kid in a very right-wing family, very, very Baptist family, that was an earth shaker, that book, you know, and it just kind of opened my eyes to, like, you know, maybe everything that I've been taught isn't perfect and right and the correct way to be and worth perpetuating into the future, you know. And so here I am, maturing. I have a partner in life now who believes in me, who has talked me into doing something profound, like going back to school and earning my degree, even though I didn't really see a real reason to do so, did it anyway. And 2 years into that degree in 2008, something crazy that I would have never thought about as the fat kid looking at my stretch marks in high school in the mirror at Cancun hotel room, I asked my wife, my girlfriend at the time, to marry me, and she said yes. And here I am. I'm now, I mean, I had, like I said, I had put on 125, by now 150-ish pounds since we first met. And she said yes, and she's going to marry me. And so, of course, I want to try to lose weight for the wedding, and I go through all of that stuff. But here's this deal. I am a huge fat guy who is about to get married to this beautiful petite woman. And that seemed like I had always dreamed of that as an adolescent. Like, one day someone's going to love me. One day that's going to happen. And I'm going to have to not be fat first. But that's not the way it worked out. I found someone who loved me despite all of that and is trying to get me to believe in myself the way she believes in me. It's a very, very powerful thing. And it was something I had always thought was impossible, right? And so she said yes. We're planning a wedding. There's that thing was the first, like, sort of axe chop in this gigantic tree of impossible that was growing in my head. It was the first whack at it. It was the first whack at it, right? And then as we go forward in time after the wedding, let me back up just a second. In 2006, this beautiful woman of mine decided to surprise me because we had just gone through something called Hurricane Katrina in 2005. And we didn't suffer very terribly from that on the west side of the storm in Thibodaux, Louisiana, which is where I actually live. New Orleans was devastated, not necessarily because of the wind, but because of the water. But they did get some wind, and it was a terrible, terrible situation. And so I was, like, distraught, wanted to know how I could help. But in the meantime, we have wind damage here in Thibodaux that we're dealing with. And so my wife and I struggled together about what could we do. What could we do to believe, to just participate in the city of New Orleans like it's not going anywhere? And that thing, to my wife, right or wrong, was she bought me season tickets, knowing that I'm a lifelong Saints fan, for the New Orleans Saints in 2016. And she surprised me with that surprise, with those tickets, the moment after we drafted Reggie Bush. We had just picked up Drew Brees, and I'm like, oh, my God, the world is coming apart. Like, this is crazy, right? So anyway, this is the woman that I'm marrying now. Now it's 2008. We're having our wedding. We're having our reception in New Orleans because she has taught me to not think of New Orleans as over there, as I have always thought of it when I was a kid growing up in the sticks. I always thought of, you know, New Orleans as them and us and them, because we're in the country, I'm on the bayou, but my wife had a different relationship with New Orleans because she had a grandparent that lived there and showed her museums and parks and all of the other things about New Orleans that are relevant besides Bourbon Street and the French Quarter. So here we are in 2008, just get married in the city of New Orleans. And then lo and behold, 2009, as season ticket holders of the New Orleans Saints, the Saints start to go off 13-0 in 2009. And we go, and it's like, oh my God, are we going to win a Super Bowl? Is this what's going to happen? That's impossible. The Saints can't do that. So sure enough, 2010, we go to Miami. The Saints win the Super Bowl. And holy cow, there's another big axe chop in this tree of impossible, right? Another big chop. Well, now I'm halfway through my college education. I'm getting close. I'm a junior. I am more pragmatic. I am more more committed to reading and fact finding. And I became interested in wondering. I was wondering a lot, like, what did Coach go through? Coach Sean Payton, who's not from Louisiana, he moved here and took us to the pinnacle, took us to the Super Bowl, and now we have a Vince Lombardi trophy sitting on Airline Highway at the big building over there in Metairie. Like, holy cow. So I read what Coach did. I read his words, his firsthand account of what took place in that season, and I read a lot about what he had encountered coming to Louisiana as a non-Louisianan in the people, in the community at large. There was a lot of complacency. There was a lot of, we're just happy to still be here after Katrina. The idea of reaching for greatness and grabbing something big and scary and chasing something big and some big and scary goal almost seems greedy, right? And Coach turned all of that on its head and had, because it's necessary for the populace to believe and expect winning for the team to actually do it. And so that all was very inspiring to me, learning what all Coach went through and how he instilled that in the city and in the players and in the front office and in me. And I used that fire to chase my degree. I knew in 2011 I was going to be ending that degree. I was going to be wrapping up that degree. And so 2010, I was like, Coach really gave me the gumption to go all out and let's finish this up like a man. Let's finish this up with pride. And so that's what I did. I was approaching this school thing with pride and dignity and self-respect. And that's something that I hadn't ever really done in my life, right? And so in 2011 rolls around, I know that at the end of the year, that fall, as a senior, I'm going to have to get up in front of people and speak. I'm going to have to get up in front of people and give a business presentation, wear a suit for my belly to be out for the world to see, tuck in my shirt, put a necktie on this 22.5-inch neck, go buy a suit of a size 62 long and a 54 waist, right? And I knew I was going to have to do all of that and stand in front of these people who were not only 10 years younger than me because I'm a non-traditional student, but 200 pounds lighter than me as well, right? So I didn't want to do that. I was very, we have a word on the bayou where we call it haunt. I was very haunt to do that. It just means, like, to be embarrassed, right? And so I started to do something about it. A friend called me in February 2011. He said, hey, man, I'm going back to the gym. You want to be my partner? I was like, yes, I'm in. Went, I joined that afternoon. And then from that moment going forward, I said, this time that I'm trying to lose weight is going to be something different. I'm going to approach this as a pragmatist. I'm going to take myself on as a case study like I've done in my studies up until this point. And we are going to be fact-based and change behaviors based on things that I know as fact, that I have learned through reading books and understanding a new word that I know now, epidemiology, to know what works when it comes to human health, losing weight, all of those things, right? So as I move forward through the year 2011, I pick up running. In the summer of 2011, I read this in this magazine called Runner's World. I'm sure everybody's familiar with it. It's a huge publication. And I read in this magazine that running is a great, great way to shed body fat. And that's what I really wanted to do, was shed body fat. I knew I had some muscles under there. I had played football my whole life. I could bench press 300 pounds. I could do all of that stuff. I knew I had muscles under the fat. How can I just get rid of the fat? And so I picked up running. Running became a thing. I was still, and I call it running, I was still 380 pounds at that time. I had gotten up to around 410, 420 pounds. When I first started running, it was more of like just a shuffle, and I was running like a 15, 16-minute mile. I called it a jiggle jog. It was very loud. There was a lot of clapping and flapping going on. But I committed to it. As a matter of fact, my friend, who was not, you know, he was 200 pounds lighter than me, he would walk next to me as I did my running, okay? And so I go forward, and I'm like, I'm very impressed because the Runner's World article is right. Weight is starting to come off a lot faster. I've never addressed food by this point, right? I'm just worried about forcing weight off of my body through sheer body force and effort and sweat equity, right? And so the end of 2011 rolls around. I lose around 55 pounds at graduation. I'm a lot lighter when I do all of those presentations that I was very anxious and worried about. And I get compliments from my professors and fellow students, and everyone's very proud, and I'm proud, right? And so as I'm developing this desire to run and wrapping up my degree all at the same time, I think about this race in New Orleans called the Crescent City Classic. The Crescent City Classic is the epitome of running in New Orleans. And so it was just a beautiful way, I thought, in my mind, to really sort of wrap running in with my city, with the city that I love, and I'm finishing up a degree. This is gonna be a new hill on the horizon for me to try to tackle. And so I signed up for my first Crescent City Classic in 2012. Graduation was behind me. All of the accolades and all of the congratulations had waned, and now I'm moving my sights towards this race that's in April at the end of Lent every year, the Saturday before Easter Sunday every year in New Orleans, and I'm working towards this as a goal. I want to finish this race in around 90 minutes. That's not a very fast 10K, but when you're a 300-pound guy, that'll work. So we get around to doing that. I do that first race. I don't finish in 90 minutes. I finish in 1 hour and 43 minutes, but I got it finished. It really, really kicked my ass. I was really, really humbled, and I had spent everything inside of me by mile 4 or 5 or so, and I was running on fumes to the end, but it taught me something. It taught me how to compete, and it taught me that I can do more than I ever thought was possible. So I get that race done, and I'm in love. I'm in love with the idea of not only running, but being involved in a race. My wife jumps on board with me right after that and says, hey, next year, I know you're disappointed, baby, but next year, let's do this race in under an hour. I was like, wow, under an hour, that's a tall order, but okay, I'm in. Let's do it. So we spent the entire summer of 2012 working, and I'm still not interested in changing my food at this point. I'm still just using my running, really, to mitigate the fact that I'm still eating oyster po' boys and shrimp po' boys and 12 packs of beer and all of that stuff, but I'm moving so much that I'm outburning my consumption when it comes to caloric intake, right? So 2013 rolls around. The Crescent City Classic is upon us. My wife decides, she read about this thing called going clean. So we start going clean, which means grass-fed and free-range, all of the bull. And so we do that. And because we live in little podunk Thibodeau, there is no grass-fed and free-range meat. So just by accident, we wind up eating a heavily plant-based diet for the entire 40 days of Lent, right up until race day, which is the Saturday before Easter and the second to last day of Lent. And so I felt amazing. I felt really good. We do that race. Lo and behold, my wife paces me for the non-runner wife paces me for a sub 1 hour 10K. We finished in 59 minutes and 56 seconds. And I was so excited. And I was fully on board. I was fully in love with running at this point. But what happened, and it's crazy how the universe will conspire for your success if you're open to it. Because what happened at this time was a friend of mine gave me a book called Born to Run. And I'm starting to really fall in love with this activity. And I'm like kind of apprehensive, like, because everybody that I know is telling me, watch out, you're a big guy, you're going to hurt your knees. Watch out, you know, all of the warnings you get, it's bad for your body, just be careful, blah, blah, blah. And so I read this book, Born to Run. And not only did I figure out, or not only did I read in this book that running is what we do as humans, that's our mode. like birds fly and kangaroos hop around and fish swim and snakes slither around on their belly. And we do bipedal locomotion. That's what human beings are. Whether you're a runner or not, you walk every day, most of us, right? And so that was very eye-opening to me. But what was even bigger in that was I learned about a guy named Scott Jurek in that book. I don't know if anyone knows who Scott Jurek is, but I learned about Scott Jurek. And as I was just starting to consider the idea of, hey, I've done a 10K twice. Maybe I should try a half marathon, full marathon, out of the question. That's for crazy people. I read this book, and here's this dude doing ultra marathons. I was like, I didn't even know that existed. So if you don't know, a marathon is 26.2 miles, and ultra marathon is anything over 26.2 miles. So Scott Jurek is running, not only is he running 50Ks and 100Ks and 100 milers, but he's running Badwater 135 through Death Valley in the middle of July at 130 degree temperatures up a damn mountain. And I'm like, holy cow, and he's doing this on a vegan diet. No man food at all. You got to remember my mindset at that point, right? I need steak. That's what I run on. I'm a man. I grew up hunting and fishing. I know how to clean a deer and catch a speckled trout. I know how to do all of that stuff. I spent my entire life learning how to develop all of these skills. So, and that's what being a man is. So, man, that was very, but just like how I didn't want to run, just like how I didn't want to go back to school, right? I said, I'm going to try it because the evidence is there. The data is glaring me in the face, and I can't deny it. I read Scott Jurek's book after I read Born to Run. Then I drilled down, and I read Rich Roll's book, Rich Roll, Finding Ultra. That blew me away. He resonated even closer to me because he was a failed college athlete. He got deep in drinking and also DWIs. Hello. We'll skip that part. And then... And then his window diet, where he eats anything that he can get in his window of his car, right? And so that really resonated with me. I learned about Brendan Brazier and all of these other very powerful vegan athletes. I'm like, holy cow. Well, not only am I learning about the athleticism that this diet can sort of bring about in one's life, but I'm also at the same time digging in on Netflix and watching Forks Over Knives and Food Matters and Frankensteer and all of these crazy documentaries. I'm like, what? I didn't know that the reason my grandmother died, the reason my grandfather has dementia, the reason my Uncle Tim died at 38 years old on a shipyard in the middle of work, the reason all of these people in my life that have died early is because of how we eat. It is insane. And so it became bigger than that to me. It became bigger than running to me at that point. It just became a thing that I need to do. This is the next step. They were talking about being manly, and is veganism being manly? What's being manly is making a right, pragmatic decision in the face of dissent, in the face of everyone else saying it's wrong, but you know it's right, and you step up and you do it any damn way because it's the right thing to do. That's what being a man is. That's what being a leader is, and that's how you progress the species, right? So I'm going all in by this point. I'm becoming, at April for my birthday, 2013, I decided to go completely plant-based. I went completely plant-based in 2013. I spent that entire summer listening to Rich Roll's podcast. If anybody knows Rich Roll, it's amazing. It's a whole nother education on top of the degree I earned, right? So I had committed to my first full marathon. I had a couple of half marathons that I was also committed to do as training on the way to my first full marathon, which was going to be in January 2014. So I go forward as a plant-based athlete now. I'm listening to Rich Roll on all of my long runs. And as I'm working and driving, I'm like just all in. I'm all over the place. I'm like, this dude's amazing. This is awesome. So I run my first half marathon, and I do something crazy for the first time because I've lost a lot of weight by then. I'm like down like 180 pounds or something. So I lost a whole bunch of weight. I get my first half marathon done. Wasn't really proud of the time, so immediately signed up for another one, and I wanted to get it in under an hour. I finished in 1:58, and immediately I said, you know, I've never put my, like, before and after pictures in a side-by-side. So I put a before picture and an after picture up, and I tweeted it to Rich Roll. And I said, because of you, I thought this was possible. And he thought that was amazing. I mean, you tweet famous people all the time, and they never say anything. And it's cool because they're busy. They got a lot going on. But he DM'd me almost immediately and said, I shared that on my Facebook page, and it blew up. It's the most popular thing I've ever posted on my Facebook page. I need to talk to you. I need to know you. So I exchanged information with him, and lo and behold, he had me on his podcast in late 2013. And I was on the podcast that had so dramatically changed my life. It was just so amazing, you know? And so he took me in under his wing, and it was my first real big introduction to this plant-based community, because now all of these people know me on social media because of Rich Roll doing that for me. And it was awesome. It was great. And I do my first. So now I'm super inspired to be an example and take forth this mandate that he had given me. He's like, before the end of that podcast, he said, dude, you need to get out and you need to tell your story. And people need to know that someone like the old you can be someone like the new you. Right now, you need to do that. I said, okay, I'm in. So it's uncomfortable. It's weird to be out in the public. I'm just a normal dude who works on shit pumps for a living. This is not like a thing. You know, I'm just a person, you know? And so I'm doing it. And so I step forward, and I know all these people are watching me, and I do my first full marathon in 2014, and it crushed me. I finished it, but it completely crushed me. I finished in 4 hours and 44 minutes. I was not even close to what I was hoping to finish in, but I finished, and I got my first marathon out of the way. It was done. Everybody was proud. Rich was all pumped for me. It was just really a beautiful thing, and almost immediately, I decided that I wanted to do one better. So in July, in New Orleans, I decided to run my second one. And it was on a 1.7-mile loop track in Audubon Park in New Orleans in the middle of July. And I ran a million loops around Audubon Park, and I finished in like 4:19. I was like, okay, that's better. And so at this same time, you got to remember, earlier in the year, I did my third Crescent City Classic. Now, an hour that's easy. I'm doing poster finishes now by this point, where I'm a top 500 finisher in the Crescent City Classic, where I get a poster finish, right? I get a commemorative poster that you can only get if you're one of the top 500 finishers in the race. So I finished in 43:08 that year. That's a whole hour off of my first year's time. And I'm feeling like somebody. I'm feeling like an athlete. I'm feeling like, I don't know, it's something. I'm feeling proud of myself. I'm feeling that same potential that my wife saw in me way back then, right? And so I do that next marathon, and I'm like, okay, I can do this. And my friend who paced me for the back half of that marathon, he had a bib to the New York City Marathon because of work. He works for a company that uses United Airlines a lot. United Airlines gave him a bib for the New York City Marathon. He said, hey, because you was on the Rich Roll podcast, you can probably do the charity thing and raise the money pretty easily on social media and get a bib to do the New York City Marathon with me at the end of the year. And I was like, boom, sounds like a great idea. Let's do it. And maybe I could break 4 hours. And so that was the goal. So we did New York City in 2014. He has since also become a plant-based athlete and a loud and proud advocate of the movement himself. So we go to New York City, and I come out, and I'm running way too fast, but I don't care. I'm not even looking at my watch. I'm just running. Long story short, I think I'm bombing at the end because I slowed way down, but I wind up coming in, and I see the clock because I'm not looking at my time. I'm just trying to run as hard as I can possibly run, and I'm not obsessing over my splits on my watch. I'm just running. So I get to the final, say, 500 meters, and I can see the clock, and I can see my time, and the time is in the 340s still. And I'm like, oh, my goodness. And I get to the finish line. I finish in 3:47:58, and all I could do, all I had the power to do at the time, is I made an Instagram post just of me, because I had to go immediately to the medical tent because I was cramping everywhere. My body was falling apart, and all I had energy to do was open Instagram and cry into Instagram and tell everyone that I loved them and I thought about them, and I worked so hard in that race because of all of the donations everyone had made to get me here. And Rich contacted me, and he said, dude, that was powerful. I need to talk to you again eventually. He's like, and Rich gave me a big, long talk about how impressed he was with my commitment and everything, and it really warmed my heart. And so what next, though? Like, I broke 4 hours in the marathon. I was so pumped about that. Well, by this time, I had developed a community around me, around my running. And not only had I, you know, become friends with some marathoners, but had also become friends with some people who had aspirations to be ultra marathoners. And these friends, Wally and Jean, they're both in the military, and one's a Marine, one's in the Army, and so they said, we're doing our first ultra marathon in Destin, Florida, on the white sandy beach of Destin. In February, and we think you can do it because you've already done 3 marathons. It's just 6 more miles to do a 50K. Boom, you got it. Let's go. So I was like, okay. I signed up, and I did my first ultra marathon in February of 2015. Destroyed me, completely destroyed me. I cried for like 8 miles because it hurt so bad. Like, if I could have quit, because it was an out and back. So if I could have quit at any point on the way back, I would have, but I had to get to the finish line to quit. So I got it done. I wasn't exactly proud of the time, but I was proud that I had done my first ultra marathon. And now I'm one of those guys that I read about. I'm one of these plant-based ultra marathoners. Holy crap, right? So now what? So I commit to doing, I was like, I'm going to double this distance by the end of the year. I'm going to sign up and do 100K. So I did 100K that October in my home state, in a race called Children of the Cane. We grow a lot of sugar cane in South Louisiana. And so this guy held a race through the sugar cane fields for 62 miles of looping around different blocks of sugar cane, and it was brutal. It was miserable. But something crazy happened in that race. Not only did I finish my first 100K, doubled the distance of the 50K, but I wound up getting a podium finish. I finished 3rd overall in that race. And I was just trying, all I was trying to do was get my finisher medal. That's all I was interested in doing. And I was like, well, wow, what if I really apply myself? And not that I wasn't applying myself, but what if I really pick a goal time instead of just generally I want to finish? What if I pick a goal time and then attack a race the same way I attacked the 4-hour marathon? So 2016, I signed up for a 50-mile race called the Bear Bait 50. And it's a 4-mile loop. It's 12 or 13 loops around this lake. You can do the math. I don't know. But it was really 53 miles, right? And so I start this race, and all my goal was to get in under 10 hours. That's what I wanted to do. I felt like that was a good, significant finish, a sub-10-hour 50-miler, 53-miler. And that was my whole approach to the race. All I did was grind. I got in there, and I started grinding, and I started working. I stayed conservative. I stayed smart. I stayed steady. And mile 40, I passed this dude who's exacerbated, and he's like, who the hell are you, and where did you come from? And I was like, I'm just running. Why? What's up? And he's like, well, his friend who was pacing him, he said, well, he was the leader until you just passed him. And I was like, whoa. I mean, like, waterworks immediately. I'm like, I'm winning an ultra marathon now? Holy shit. So I just keep pushing and keep putting. Now I'm running from this dude because I'm scared. I don't want to give the lead back up. Right? So I wound up putting 15 minutes on him before the end of the race and wound up first place overall. I won the Bear Bait 50 in 2016. And not only did I win, but here's what was really cool about that race. My whole family was there with me, right? So since I went plant-based in 2013, about 6 or 8 months later, because I come from a really big family, a really unhealthy family, everyone was on on blood pressure meds or cholesterol meds and all of the stuff that goes along with cardiovascular disease, right? And so 6 or 8 months into it, my mom goes plant-based. My Bam Bam is now plant-based. My brother, my sister. As a collective, my whole family has lost about 900 pounds, right? And so they're all at this race with me, watching me win a 50-mile race, right? And my Bam Bam is there, high-fiving me and crying. And he can really see what's happening, what's going on. He's got progressive dementia. But in that moment, he knew what I had done. He knew what we had done. And it was amazing. It was beautiful. And it was like, how do we top this moment? What next? And what next is when you're an ultramarathoner, the granddaddy of them all, besides you know, bad water and those types of things, the granddaddy distance is your 100-mile race. Or are you going to do a 100-mile race? Am I going to do a 100-mile race? That's so, wow. So I mulled over it for a little while, but in the meantime, I did the Crescent City Classic again that year. I'm getting closer and closer to 40 minutes at that point. I'm at 41:07, and so I'm getting faster and faster in that. I do my next marathon. I finish my next marathon in like 3 hours and 24 minutes. And all this time I'm thinking, am I going to do a 100-mile race? I committed. I picked a race. I said, yes, I'm going to do a 100-mile race. I picked a race in Florida. I went back to the same neighborhood of the Bear Bait 50 and picked a race in very close to that course in the panhandle of Florida in September. So September 3rd, 2016, I was in the start corral of my very first 100-mile race. Scared to death, but prepared. And it was hot. It was 104 degree with the heat index that day. I got my first 50 miles in the 10-hour goal that I wanted to do, because then that would leave me 14 hours for the next 50 to get in under 24 hours, which was my goal for my first 100-mile race, was a sub-24-hour effort in my first 100-mile. So we get through the day, and then the night comes, and it's thunderstorming, and it's raining, and it's just miserable. And I'm staring at a circle of light on the ground for 12 hours of darkness, right? And around mile 80, my world started to come apart. I was cramping everywhere. My mindset was really poor. I was starting to feel like this wasn't going to happen. But luckily, my buddies that were there in my very first ultra marathon, we had all paced each other for our first 100 milers, and they were there with me, and they walked me through it and said, look, man, we're not quitting. We're not giving up. Just keep moving. Your legs will come back. Let's get some calories in you. Let's get some water in you. Stop crying. Let's keep going. So we pushed through. By mile 85, I'm starting to feel okay again, 86, 87. By mile 91 or so, the sun comes up, and that really brightened my spirits. And then from there on in, next thing you know, I'm like negative splitting all the way. It's like the horse could smell the barn. I'm going crazy. And in my last mile was my fastest mile of the entire 100-mile race, and I ran a 7:50 split in my very last mile of my 100-mile race, and I was climbing on second place. I almost caught second place. I finished in 22 hours and 45 minutes. Second place came in 45 seconds faster than me. So that was my first 100-mile race, and I can talk about it, and I can try and convey that feeling to you as much as I can with words. It doesn't work nearly as well as the video I posted earlier, and it's on social media if you could check it out, and you can hear that real guttural scream that comes out of me as I cross the finish line. My brother crossed the finish line with me, who's also lost over 100 pounds by this point as well, and it was just a real powerful thing. But something crazy also happened in that year. In the end of the year 2016 was that very magazine that had clued me into running as a good way to lose body fat had me on the cover in 2016, December 2016. I was on the cover of Runner's World magazine. And then this year at the Crescent City Classic, something I had been working hard for 3 years running, I wanted to break 40 minutes in the 10K, and I wound up coming in 39:55 this year at the Crescent City Classic. And that was amazing, right? It's just like such a full circle thing. It was a beautiful, beautiful experience. And so I've done all of this stuff with running and plants and social media and and trying to be a part of a community that's really, honestly, without, this is not hyperbole when I say it's going to change the world and make the human race better, right? To be a part of that has been something very profound for me. And I've done all of this stuff in running, and I'm proud of all of my stuff that I've been able to accomplish in running. It makes me feel good about me. It makes me feel good about myself, something that I haven't participated in a very long time. For most of my life, I haven't really done that, right? And I feel good about me. But what's next, though? What's next? What's next to me? What's next to me is something that's even more relevant and important to the movement, which is to, you know the old adage, learn one, do one, teach one. Well, now it's time for me to turn around and put a helping hand back to the people that are on the bayou, the people that are in small communities all up and down Lafourche Parish, in the swamps of Louisiana, who will never, ever voluntarily go to a veg fest, who will never, ever voluntarily subscribe to become the V word, right? Now, my goals, I still have running goals, obviously. I still would like the Boston Qualified. That's a whole nother story. We'll go there later. So, but now my big goals are I want to help make a change in the community that I am from. I want to help make a change in South Louisiana. I want to help make a change in Louisiana as a whole. I want to help make a change in the fact that we lead the nation, or one of the leaders in the nation, in diseases of the heart and obesity and cancer and all of those things. We are way up at the top, and it's all really simple. It's because we eat animals as food, as like almost a sport. And it's got to change. It's got to change. We are killing the human race by eating animals. It's insanity. And once you know this stuff, once you understand the facts, you can't unknow it. You can't unring that bell. So it's up to me to go to my people who will not voluntarily come to these things. So now it's up to me to go to my people and ring that bell where I'm from and plant those seeds and hopefully precipitate some change in my very community that precipitated that big 400-pound man from before, right? And it's up to all of us, it's up to all of us to use these assets that are essentially human, of endurance, of problem solving, of bipedal locomotion, all of these things of our propensity to clump into groups and be and create community and movements, right? It's up to us to use those human assets to keep this ball rolling forward. And that's why I am extremely proud to be here and be able to have a one-hour, one-sided conversation with you guys about me and my story. I mean, I'm forever grateful for organizations like Brother Wolf to bring someone like me in and let me speak, let me talk, let me answer questions. I think we'll have a little bit of time, so I'll answer some questions if anybody has any of those as well. But just a sincere, deep thank you to every one of you sitting here and coming to listen to me. Dude from Chack Bay, Louisiana, it's like, okay. But here you are, you're listening, you're paying attention, and it feels good. I can feel it. And thank you to Brother Wolf for extending the invitation and bringing me up here. It's been amazing. And with that, I would love to take questions if people have questions. I see you with the hat. What's up?
Hi.
Hello, I saw you running this morning.
Did you?
I sure did. I'm jealous because I'm nursing a little injury right now.
Oh, I remember you.
Yeah, I'm nursing a little. I saw you right there by the coffee shop.
Yeah,
you said
hello so friendly. Picked up my run for me. My question to you is, I really enjoy that. I've been a runner for years and years and years. I mean, not officially, ma'am. But then I started racing about 10 years ago.
You were officially a runner the day you were born.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, but go ahead.
Okay, so my question is, what is your number one fuel in your marathon and ultra marathons? Because as a vegan, I've been playing around with that so much.
Let me know when you get it figured out just right.
I mean, I've gone from dates.
So there's no number one. I would say my biggest advice on fueling is pre-race fueling. So the days leading up to the race are very important. And I have a protocol. I don't know if it works or not. All I can do is tell you what I do, right?
Right, right.
And so there are people faster than me. There are people who don't bonk in mile 22 like I did a couple of weeks ago in Liverpool. But what I like to do is the week of the race, I like to start off race week with at least a 24-hour fast.
Okay.
I'll do Monday with a complete fast all day Monday if I'm racing Saturday, right? I'll do a fast all day Monday. I may go till after lunch on Tuesday. And then from Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, I'm going to try to stay in a calorie and a caloric surplus, which shouldn't be hard because we should be tapering if it's race week, right? So
right.
Our calorie burn should be way down.
Right.
So I'm going to stay in a caloric surplus with foods like potatoes, grains, really carbohydrate-rich foods, clean foods. Mm-hmm. But I'm also wanting to keep a lot of fiber in there as well early in race week so I can help move all of the food through me and out of me before it's time to go on race day. I stop eating fibrous foods like on, say, lunchtime on Friday, the day before race. And I find that I really feel light. I feel light and I feel fueled for shorter distances when I'm really going hard. Half marathon, I really don't fuel during the race. If it's not a race that's going to take me longer than an hour and 30 minutes, then I'm not really worried about fueling per se on the race, like during the race. Right. And then I must admit that there are vegan goos and gels that you can use. I think even the goo brand itself
is
vegan.
Yes.
So is the Huma gels.
Yes.
I don't really care for the chia seeds in there on race day. For me, it didn't work so well. I like the caloric density of the goos better, and I use that during a marathon. But I still haven't dialed in exactly how much because this last marathon can attest I completely bombed out. In around mile 18, 19, 22, I was walking and jogging. I was completely shot. So I'm still experimenting with that myself. I'm still a newbie runner. That's my sixth marathon. I've been running since 2011-ish, you know. Mm-hmm. So I'm still learning. But on the longer stuff where it's a lower heart rate, I'll be using a lot more of the eating food. Like I like Bearded Brother bars. That's a great one. I love them. There's a Outrageous Orange and Kale bar. It's superb. I had a gigantic box of those for my 100 miler. That's the only thing that I ate was Bearded Brother bars.
Right.
I used Tailwind for some liquid calories as I would go. And I used something for electrolytes called EnduroPacks. It's just a pure electrolyte spray that I spray in all my water bottles and everything as I take in hydration. And that's basically it. For the most part, it's about training and your overall diet, which I'm assuming is probably pretty good.
Thank you.
Very welcome. Yes, ma'am.
So, a comment and question.
Yeah, shoot.
Normally I'm super loud.
Yeah.
Thanks. Thank you. So, I just wanted to ask you less a question about running and more a question about culture. I use you as an example in my clinic when I talk to my patients about going plant-based.
Right.
And full disclosure, the description I give is, this is a gentleman who lost a bunch of weight, came from a very meat and heavy culture, hunting, etc., then lost his mind and started running ultramarathons.
Right.
But the question that I have is, you know, I grew up in a vegetarian household, so the transition for me was a lot easier. So it's sometimes hard for me to get the message across well to folks who have grown up in a hunting and fishing culture. So you've clearly done that with great success in your own community. So what are the kinds of things that you say to people when they're telling you, you know, because I get people go, well, deer meat's healthy for you.
Well, this isn't a very popular thing with this crowd, I'm sure. But where I live, you got to meet people where they are, right?
Yeah.
And so where I live, people still do those activities daily, right? And so if I can get someone, just through my example, to take the step of stop buying the meat in the dairy from the grocery store, and if you're still so, because you got to remember earlier in my talk how connected to the activity of hunting and fishing I was. It was bigger than the food that it produced. It was about tradition and all of those things, right? And so in a lot of weird ways, I'm almost lucky that my grandfather doesn't even remember what hunting is, because I don't have the added pressure of him wanting me to take him anymore. And I know that people still live in that world and still have their whole family that goes to the hunting camp every weekend. And so I prescribe a 100% plant-based diet. And I also tell people that's how I live. And I would love to see you take the step of getting rid of the CAFO-induced food in your life. And that's the only thing. That's the only... And the biggest thing that I provide to those people at home is my undying, enduring, never off example. So if we're at a birthday party or a christening or a boucherie or a Mardi Gras party, I'm always on. I don't care. It doesn't matter if it's so-and-so's birthday. I'm not, if it's a crawfish boil and Lent just ended. I'm not participating, even for one bite. Because that, in my mind, is the best way for me to serve as an example for the people still participating in that. Because they'll look at me and go, oh, well, Josh lost 220 pounds, and he still eats cracklings, and he still eats boudin. So I don't, even if it's just one bite a year, not happening. Not happening, because it's bigger than the palate.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Also ran marathons for 4 years. Went plant-based in January and lost 70 pounds.
Sweet.
But he seems to have plateaued around 230.
Oh, the plateau question.
So did that happen to you, or
of course,
do you eventually continue to lose weight?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And that's what happens is you don't make enough food changes. You haven't really made all the changes necessary to get to the end, right? So... For an example, when I was 420 pounds, I could cut it back to, say, one po' boy a day and still lose weight. But once my default calorie burn dips to a point to where that no longer works because I've lost 40 pounds and now I'm not burning that extra 400 calories a day to carry that extra bit of ass around, right? My food choices become glaringly obvious that they haven't changed nearly enough. And so that's really one of the ways that this plant-based thing became so palatable to me in the beginning, was because I had stalled out at 300 pounds. I was floating back and forth between 290 and 315 or so, right? And I think we're running out of time. I don't know. I think someone's coming up. Yeah, so I'm gonna have to shut it down. I'll take your question okay. Oh, God, because I'm not standing in front of you in my underwear. It's there. But it's not as bad as I thought it was going to be as a 400-pound man. There's not nearly as much extra material on my skin as there is in my old fat clothes. Totally. Totally. And the plant-based diet, I think, really also does. So sorry, guys. I would love to just stand here and take questions all day, but thank you. Thank you very much. Seriously, thank you a lot. I appreciate it. Peace.